Hi, it's Tim Clark, the End Times Matrix, introducing today a show with Anthony Patch, and this show is called CERN Mad Do, Recreating the Big Bang. And we're going to start off today with some of the interesting rituals that are associated with CERN that some people may not be aware with, and then we'll transition into talking with Anthony regarding some things that we want to clear up regarding CERN, and then we'll progress from there. So we're going to start off with Chris. I'm going to highlight her for her presentation. And go ahead, Chris, when you're ready.
Okay, highlight my box, Anthony.
Alrighty.
All right, let's click my box and do this presentation here. Okay. Make sure that I have that. There we go. All right. I just did this quick thing here so that way we can kind of show some things that goes on inside CERN that I wasn't aware of, because we're always searching for the spiritual and critical and the physics and all those things and how it's going to affect things. But they do a lot of dances at CERN, and there's a lot of dances, and I didn't put all the pictures because they're very this is one that doesn't show anything, but there's a lot of very nude pictures showing all the body parts, and they do weird dances, and they have choreographers that do these things in CERN. So I didn't put those in, and I have some links that I haven't added yet to the video, but I will. But this is just to kind of show you know, what they do here in CERN. And if you haven't seen this video at CERN, look it up. It's very weird. I think that maybe this is the yin and yang, the white and black checkerboard with, you know, that they show in Freemasonry. And was wondering if this guy here was like the God particle. It seems that he can't see him, but he senses that he's there. And this represents the Ka in Egypt, which is part of the soul, or the, you know, part of the five parts of the spirit, body, soul. And here is some more pictures here. This round Saturn's eye always shows a lot of videos when it's in the barren desert. And here's the circle here. This is when they go through the I guess they said this dance was inside CERN. I'm not really sure how they actually filmed it, but, you know, this guy's falling, and they show them falling through a portal. And here's another silly picture with them dancing in their panties. Here's some more pictures of them dancing. They call it the brain dance, Mobius strip, the spider galaxies. So it just shows that it is a very spiritual thing to them. Here is, you know, another picture of CERN and the collider. Kind of looks like the Saturn V5 rocket when it comes apart with the hole. It looks exactly like that. And here is the Saturn Sanskrit plates. This is a genie demon dancer that kind of looks like Shiva and Kali that are one deity. And then there are some more videos. I'll put this under, but they had a big conference at CERN, and they showed their feelings of punishment, and they showed videos at this huge conference that they had, and they showed a guy whipping the mountain, whipping the water. I think at one point he was in his underwear, but I didn't put that one. Here he is whipping another mountain, and he explains some things in there. And yesterday we did a video, and we showed this too. This is the award. It's a for CERN for the best Twitter page, and this is very symbolic to the occultist. And then I just put some plasma pictures of the dome. This is an actual plasma thing that they did at CERN, and here's another one. And here's a quote from Stephen Hawking. He warned that the reactivation in March of CERN's Large Hadron Collider could pose grave dangers to our planet. So he said himself that the God particle could destroy the universe, leaving time and space collapsed to recreate the Big Bang within a man-made structure that has frightened him. What has frightened him so much? You know, do they know what they know, what they know what they're doing? Because, I mean, Stephen Hawking knows this machine inside out, and he's saying that, you know, this month when they started up, I think it's March 3rd, but we'll go more into that with Anthony. Here is a quote from Anthony, author Anthony Patch, that we have today. It's a directed energy weapon, rendering all weapons, including nuclear, obsolete. So that's the end of that, and we will get on with our interview with Anthony Patch. Sorry, Tim. It wouldn't let me close out of it. There we go.
That's all right. Cool. All right. So we're going to move on with Anthony. Anthony, how you doing?
Very good. Great to be back with you guys.
Well, we always enjoy everything you have to provide for us, and everybody out there is waiting for the breaking news today, what you want to share with them regarding CERN, and what clear up some misconceptions and also share the new information.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, we'll go through a few of the dates and startups and things like that, but as Chris posted there, one of the things that or applications of CERN, the technology there, is as a directed energy weapon. And to define that, you're taking particles, subatomic particles, that are accelerated to 99.9% of the speed of light. And I should correct myself. They're not subatomic. We're talking about particles that are the size of an ion, which is an atom that has been stripped of its electrons. So you picture it in its simplest form, taking atoms and smashing them together at the speed of light and creating massive amounts of energy. CERN is a large synchrotron. When we speak of the main ring, that is a synchrotron device, meaning that it generates synchrotron energies. These synchrotron machines, CERN being the largest, is replicated in smaller forms at smaller labs, such as Brookhaven in New York. I've cited the one at Berkeley several times, what they call their advanced light source synchrotron device. These all have arms that radiate out from the main ring, including the Large Hadron Collider. These are called beam lines. The purpose of the beam line is to take this energy and direct it towards an endpoint. At that endpoint are collectors to perform specific experiments, depending on the type of particles that have been collided, and therefore the types of energies. For example, at Berkeley, they're generating what they call the brightest light ever generated by man, 100,000 times brighter than the sun itself. Now, light is kind of a misnomer in the sense that you cannot see the light that is being generated at Berkeley with their synchrotron. They're generating X-rays, the highest powered X-rays that have ever been created. The purpose of those X-rays in one application is to look at DNA, the proteins of our DNA that I've mentioned before. And I will come back to DNA later on today in our discussion. But getting back to the beam lines, directed energy weapon, there are beam lines that come off of the Large Hadron Collider at CERN that terminate in certain experiments that they're performing on a larger scale with higher energies. These beam lines, to make my point, can be utilized as the barrel of a gun, terminating or opening and allowing particles and energy to escape from the Large Hadron Collider, much as a bullet would escape from the barrel of a gun. And I'll stop right there.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, is that it almost acts as a rifling, kind of the helical rifling to direct a particle. And I think other people are picking up on this Dew directed energy weapon concept, and it's pretty well. You think what would happen with dealing with this much energy? I mean, what are you going to do with this kind of energy, generating that kind of energy? And of course, the military applications are always at the top of the list when people invest money.
Certainly, and one of the, if you look at this strategically from a military standpoint, what would you do with a weapon like this? A great question. You can, in my estimation, hold the world hostage. You have a weapon now that has effectively rendered all weapons, including nuclear weapons, obsolete. You have, in the parlance of Star Trek, a planet destroyer. This is real. This is factual. Going back 10 years at least in the literature that I've read in the military journals, they were stating at that time that they had a weapon 10 years ago that rendered nuclear devices obsolete. Now we are seeing that coming forth. It's out in the open. It's there if you choose to find it, if you choose to read it. Certainly, the people at CERN are not talking about this in a public forum, like their dance videos and whatnot that you're relating to. But it's there, and I have read the information where they have stated that this now has rendered nuclear warheads obsolete. So the nub of this issue is they can't hold the world hostage and say, you need to get rid of all of your nuclear weapons, which we've seen that progression going on already for many years. We're seeing our president calling for the elimination, although he's in negotiations with Iran about their nuclear program, which is rather interesting. But that's all a smokescreen. That's all public consumption. That's all public fodder. That has nothing to do with what is really going on, and that is the fact that they now can say to every country, and remember, every country participates in CERN, so this is circular. They can now say to the world at large, which means you and me as the regular surf class person, as I like to put ourselves, that there will be the need for everyone to bow down to the New World Order, to the single government, to remove all sovereignties of all nations. There will be no nation states. There will be one world state under the auspices of the United Nations. And any country that defies that edict could suffer at the hands of a directed energy weapon upon their country, either in a very defined fashion in a small target, with minimal collateral damage as a demonstration, and we have seen some information about that occurring in our country. I'll leave it up to the two of you if you want to delve into that demonstration. But I believe that this is leading to the signing of the 7-year peace treaty that is stated in Scripture. And again, I'll stop there.
Chris, you want to chime in?
Yeah. You know, I never put that together until you mentioned that to me before, but I think that it's just interesting the timing of everything. I think they do everything on their own timing, and there's some collaboration with the world leaders behind the scenes that we don't know about, just like the Trans-Pacific Partnership. But I think that in this timing, there's a lot of talks about an EMP. Possibly taking out the grid at any time. And to me, I mean, that might be something that could play into their timing of this collider if they are going to open a portal, bring in the Antichrist, whatever they, plan on doing. We don't know for, exactly sure until it happens, but could it be possible if they did an EMP that they could knock out the grid and then they would say, okay, well, now we don't have a computer system anymore. We have this quantum computer. If anybody wants to be a part of this is a biological computer. You have to be connected to it with a one world identity, and that's the only way. Because if an EMP hits and the grid goes down, people are going to freak out if they can't get on their computers, because I think that was part of their plan, because they had this technology way before they put it out on the internet and the phones and everything else. So I think it's part of their plan to get people to really want to connect to the new computer, and that's what this is all about in these end times. So,
yes, when Tim speaks of the areas that he's paying attention to in the mainstream media, be it television, movies, etc., you're looking at precognitive programming, meaning preparing people's minds to accept something that's coming at them from the future. You look at people walking around today on the streets focused on their phones. You see people in their homes focused on television. You are conditioning people to be connected to the internet. If you cut off that, what does that do to them psychologically? And I'll let you take it from there.
Yeah, I think we've talked about before the connection with the mark of the beast and the computer, the Hebrew language. We can't go over all that all today, but the www666, the code of the number code for computer, when you spell out the word for the Bible code, is 666. So computer 666, www666, the Shin letter is 666 with the three vavs. And so I know that in itself, symbolically, and you know how they have prepared people through the entertainment industry, and you know, it's all about the conscious mind, what they're doing to people in their conscious mind, and trying to guide people into believing what they want them to believe and to connect in these end times. I think that once these things actually happen, the people that are willing to look at the truth, which is the Lord, Jesus Christ, and willing to open up their heart, they will say, you know what, I'm not going to bow down to the government. I'm not going to bow down to the New World Order or Obamacare or any of those things, and have faith, because once you get, I think that they'll know what they're kind of, I mean, I think that the Lord will give everyone a chance. Of course he does, you know, to accept him. And there's unfortunately going to be a lot of people that don't want to. They want the world and the patterns of the world and all the symbology and the occult that came, started a long time ago with Sanskrit and the Egyptians and all those things. That's where it came from. And if people search very deeply into what they believe and find the very core roots of it, they will see that Satan is a trickster. The love and the light and the peace and the evolution and evolve into the quantum computer at some point, that is just a trick. And it is for him to gather as many souls as he can. And so that's why we're here today, is to explain this. I mean, we're so glad to have Anthony here to get the right information of what CERN is all about, and he explains it in a way that we can understand. Still some things I have to figure out, but he does explain it well. So,
yeah, the I guess as far as the precognitive stuff, talking about that, there's a few biblical things I'm concerned about. The calling down fire from heaven, some of these end time events that are supposed to be demonstrative of the Antichrist character, and coordinating with things like CERN, you know, where it's more of a Wizard of Oz kind of who's behind the curtain pulling the levers when somebody's standing out in front with the fire all around them, you know, in the fiery furnace or whatever, and who's pulling the levers. It makes me think in that direction that it's a coordinated deception. Of course, in the alien aspect of it, too. that we have talked about. But this DEW technology, it makes sense with all the satellites up there now, that they can have just a targeting grid of targets that they can say this is our threat matrix. These cities need to be made examples out of because they are revolting against the New World Order, very Hunger Games like. And let's put it on TV and show the world what happens when you resist the New World Order, you know. And then some kind of pulse weapon, you know, CERN thing. I don't know. What do you think about all that?
Well, I agree with you, and it goes back to, you know, Skynet, the whole discussion of Skynet that we have had before. You guys still have me? I'm not sure.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Good. The Skynet is very real, and one of the things that ties into that, besides the fact that CERN can be used as a directed energy weapon, is Chris mentioned it a couple of times, and that's the quantum computer. And I like to define the quantum computer because this is something that very few people are really talking about. And it puzzles me to an extent, but also amuses me, that very little mainstream media coverage, even in the computer magazines and publications, very little has been spoken of in terms of the adiabatic quantum computer. Now, this figures heavily in both of my books. The reason that it does is because this sets us up for artificial intelligence. The computer model that came out this year that I don't want to say I predicted, it was an extrapolation mathematically of model numbers, 2048, I said in my book, 2048 Diamonds in the Rough, part of that title encompasses this adiabatic quantum computer's model number, which 10 years ago was projected by the manufacturer to be introduced in early 2015. And I mentioned this in a previous conversation we've had, but just to reiterate, they announced the 2048 this year, but they failed to mention the other half of the specifications, and that is that they were going to achieve artificial intelligence in early 2015 with this computer. Their press release failed to mention that this year. The other part of that is the fact that that computer has the equivalent computational power, processing power, of all of the human minds on the planet combined, over 7 billion human brains. Now imagine how much computational power we have within our own head. I mean, science has said that it's nearly incomprehensible, the ability of for the brain to process information. If you multiply that by 7 billion, again, it's incomprehensible the capability of this single computer. Now, there are multiple generations of this computer, but to try to keep this short and focused, the purpose of this adiabatic quantum computer, which is not based on transistors, it is based on qubits, is to control the energy that is released by CERN during these collisions this year, and specifically the opening of the portal, because in 2012, when they attempted to open the portal, some say accidentally, there were giants, Nephilim, that appeared briefly coming through a dimensional portal such that they actually brought in the Swiss military and the local Swiss police into their jurisdiction, which is much like the Vatican City in the sense that no one is allowed into that jurisdiction unless they are invited. So why would they invite these outside forces? Well, they were panicked. The machine was shut down. The magnets were quenched. They were damaged. They were destroyed. Thus the shutdown and the rebuilding with new magnets. The point here is the adiabatic quantum computer is critical to the opening and controlling of the forces involved with this portal later this year, between September and December of this year. And we'll go into some of the dates in a minute.
Don't you find that fascinating, though, that here they were given a glimpse into their future of being destroyed by this Nephilim giants, and they said, well, let's go ahead and fix it and start it up again.
And at that time, they did have the early version of the adiabatic quantum computer, but they did not have the one that they have today. So it was a combination of things. One, they didn't have the computer to control what was going on with the Large Hadron Collider at that point. And therefore, I believe, number two, this was an accidental opening. But it gave them not only a glimpse into another dimension, but it gave them a glimpse of how much power do we really need to finally establish a fixed portal, not a temporary one. And we'll go into talking about that connection with Saturn and where that permanent opening and connection will take place.
Okay. So they have this computer that we don't know, no one really understands what it is, but it's there. You can read about it. It's going on behind the scenes, and we're not connected to it. They are connected to it. And I've read about it, and what I understand is it's a interdimensional type computer that connects to another dimension.
That's correct. The simplest explanation of this is that what they're doing is they are taking a problem, an equation. They call it a combinatorial programming problem. And as they describe it themselves, the manufacturer describes it openly, they are inserting the problem into another dimension. In that dimension, the problem is processed. The solution is then extracted from the other dimension back into our usable frame of reference, in our dimension, if you will. Now, this has to do with quantum processing. It gets into quantum entanglement. It gets into, if you will, picture a mathematical problem operating or being processed by a tiny, tiny, tiny quantum-sized calculator. That calculator exists in another dimension, meaning in a quantum state you're dealing with as many as 11 dimensions, perhaps more. But there are acknowledged 11 dimensions. And so there's a direct correlation between running computations in another dimension and controlling an interdimensional portal. There's a direct crossover there. Again, you're taking the micro, the quantum, and you're dealing with the macro. Again, we love to say, as above, so as below.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, now I understand that in ancient times they connected to Saturn. That's what their goal was. And Saturn is sort of like a computer. I'm wondering, is Saturn a lot like CERN? I don't know, but I do know that it's some sort of type of computer, and you mentioned before about the strangelets and Ceres and, you know, the dwarf planet and how that could possibly connect to this whole process that they're doing. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, in my estimation, and actually I picked this up from some of our conversations that we've had before, but the conclusion that I've come to, and this sounds so far-fetched, but I really want and encourage people to take away their preconceived notions, put away their prejudice, open up their mind, all of those things, and look at this through the lenses of spirituality. That is the other dimension we're talking about, the spiritual realm. Within Saturn itself, I believe, reside the spirits, the energies, the essence, if you will, that were thrown out of heaven, that they're imprisoned in Saturn. It sounds completely ridiculous. But when I look at the physics of what they're trying to accomplish and why are they targeting Saturn with the Large Hadron Collider by way of an electric plasma conduit, a helical shaped conduit. Why target Saturn? What does it have? Well, it has the beings that they want to bring to Earth. And that's reflected in the ancient studies that you have brought forth. Mm-hmm. And I'm grateful to. Now, Ceres coming into the picture, I think actually you can explain that better. I hate to put it back onto you, but I think you can explain Ceres from the ancient studies and the gods that are involved. The gods that are involved with Ceres than I can, because that's not my area of expertise. But the timing is perfect, because it is entering into our solar system, and we do have a probe at Ceres, and we're watching it, and there has to be a connection with Saturn, as well as with Jupiter.
Yeah, there is. I think that Saturn is, you know, the Bible talks about Saturn. And from my studies, I understand, and you can even look it up from, I think, a NASA's point of view and scientists, it's the location of it is in the netherworld. There's a netherworld in the abyss, and so when we look at the celestial realms above, underneath the ground, is different. When you mix metals and alchemy underneath the ground, it's different from when you mix them above the ground, because below, because that's why CERN is so below the ground, is because it connects to the celestial realms. There's some kind of dimensional connection with below the ground and above in the celestial realms that connects to what's going on in the cosmos. And I think that with Saturn, you know, with my research with Egypt and the resurrection to Saturn with Jupiter, that is the same thing as Mithraism, which they worship Jupiter, and there's a lot of Mithric churches in 70, I think it was BC, I could be wrong, AD, it was the church that was destroyed was a Jupiter temple, and it evolved into all the priesthood. I mean, they had thousands of priests, and just like they did, Egypt had thousands of priests, and so did the Levites and the Catholics, and you know, they did all these things behind the scenes with the occults, and that's why they had these Mithric temples. Mithra is the one that the Freemasons worship. You see him as a lion holding a space and time, the keys, mm-hmm. and he's standing on the world with the X, and he's also the one with the cap and the zodiac around him. And he was just like the egg from Egypt, the primordial egg that you can read about in the Book of the Dead, is the same thing as the Greeks and the Romans. Their art is a little bit different, and their statues and all of those things over time is a little bit different, but their belief system is the same, and they all worship Jupiter. And that's why the temple was in honor of him. And the Vatican put up a Jupiter statue, and there was a lot of controversy about that, so he took it down. Now, Hermes as Anubis holding his caduceus is still up, and all of his other pagan statues are up at the Vatican, and a lot of their sun worship symbolism and everything. But I just wanted to point all those things out, you know, with the connection with everything, because these big world leaders are involved, and they this is their goal. The occult are getting ready for Armageddon. This is biblical, because we know in the Bible that there is going to be an Armageddon at the end, and these are the things that they are preparing for. They know exactly what they're doing. But I think that everybody should be aware of it, and everybody should be able to prepare however God has them prepare, and however God puts it on their heart.
Well said.
Yeah, I had a question. I think I remember one of the people working with CERN discussing breaking physics, and brought me to the point of going, well, why would you even consider that concept to break reality or that we know? Mm-hmm. What's in it for us to break physics. And there is nothing in it for us, the peasants, of course, but there is something in it for followers of Pan or Cernunnos or whoever, you know, CERN is dedicated to. But I guess when I was thinking about the dimensions, I do remember in the old sci-fi stuff when the first Superman movies, the villains were imprisoned in a flat plane. A plane of existence that was flat. And we're talking about different planes, and the Freemasons have their columns that separate these planes, whatever, and it's, some folks have talked about collapsing the columns or collapsing the planes. Would that be something that you would consider when we talk about breaking physics?
Yes. It's interesting you mentioned the old Superman movie and the villains being trapped in the flat plane. That, I think, is a great example of Saturn. And essentially that's where, you know, that symbolism crosses over from the movie to Saturn itself. There is so much tied in the ancient studies to Saturn itself that it's obvious that they still worship Saturn. And we see that in corporate logos all over the world, that Saturn is reproduced over and over. So we have to take this pragmatically, rather than just simply discounting the notion that there are spirits contained within a gaseous globe with rings around it that we call a planet, and simply say, these people are nuts. I'm speaking of myself being nuts. Mm-hmm. That may be the case, but I believe that if you look at the facts, which is what they are doing in physics, what they are doing spiritually, and we're going to go into the dance routines in a minute if you want to talk about people that are nuts, but they are worshiping. They're using the machine to worship spirits, fallen angels, past entities, past gods, including Saturn itself, and they want to bring those entities to our plane of existence. Now, as far as breaking physics, what they are trying to do, and I'm going to quote, and I won't cite the person, but this is coming from a physicist at CERN, they want to send us back to the beginning of time. So when you talk about breaking physics, let's talk about Einstein, relativity. Can you go back in time? Now, I don't go into time and time warps and time travel in any of my books and publications. I let other people deal with that. But is CERN a time machine? That's a question that's been put forth. I don't even deal with it. I won't even go there. It's possible, certainly, but it detracts, I think, from what we are trying to focus on, so I don't go into it. But they are essentially trying to recreate what they call the Big Bang, the moment of creation. They're trying to create their own moment of creation. Mm-hmm. So if they are doing that, they have to have three things. They have to have the Trinity. And let me stop there, because I know you want to talk about what the Trinity means and the mirror, the replicating, the mimicking that they do. So go ahead and jump in if you wanted to say something on the Trinity.
Well, you know, first I wanted to say, and I want you to get into the dates and everything that they're not publishing, but I wanted to say that they do say they're trying to recreate this Big Bang. And it is true that the scientists say that the Milky Way was caused by a Big Bang. And so with all the mythology and the symbology and the connections, and not only that, the Dendera maps of Egypt, and what they would do to go on the boat of Ra and sail through the celestial realms on their solar boat, and this is something I think they're looking for, is Ra, which is the god of Saturn, which is, this is what I believe, but anyway, the important connection here is that in March this month, they are going to start this thing up, and in September, and these are the 2 months that during the equinoxes that the Egyptians would go on their solar boat over the Milky Way, and they would sail through the 12 constellations. And this is according to their text, you know, and information. I mean, it's anyone can find that information, but and I've put it out there in videos, but that's just interesting that they're going to start these, you know, this thing up during the same months. And then we have the black sackcloth sun, and that ties in the Book of Esther and the Purim holiday. And then the Pope is going to address Congress in September, I think the day after they're going to start this up. But there is an enormous amount of connections with the ancient cult and with the timing of the spring and autumn equinoxes. And I was reading that during this time, there is a refraction of the sun. It has to do with the sun and how the sun refracts and the equator with certain settings of the constellations and the planets. I mean, this is something that they understand well more than what I do, but I do understand that that has a lot to do with that. So what do you have on the dates, and can you explain the dates and how they're – this is kind of like an escalation that they're getting to in September. And if they saw the demons coming through, which I heard that there were a lot of reports, police reports and different things – when they rev that up, and I saw a picture of a lot of damage. It's really hard to find anything on it. I think they scrubbed a lot of stuff, yeah. But if they already did that, I can't even imagine if they rev this thing up and the escalation that they have with this quantum computer too on that end, I just can't imagine what it's going to be like when they start this thing up in September. But can you tell us the dates and what it means with the TEV and all that stuff and the electrons?
Yeah, sure. Be happy to. There have been some misunderstandings of the startup date. So I'm going to define, first of all, what does it mean to start up the machine? Then we'll go to the dates. The machine has a complicated process of multiple accelerators leading to the main ring. They have a straight line linear accelerator feeding into smaller circular synchrotron accelerators, all feeding higher and higher speeds of particles circulating in one direction around small synchrotrons that then feed into the main ring. When those accelerated particles, let's just call them beams, are injected into the main ring, they then are in opposing directions. They circulate around the ring in opposite directions, thus creating the opportunity for a collision to occur within a detector. The collision occurs when the beams are crossed. Now, you've heard that in Ghostbusters, okay? Don't cross the stream, okay? I love the movies.
With the step pyramid and the everything up there.
that movie is so occult, it's not even funny. But anyway, let's get back to the crossing of the streams within the detectors. That's where the collisions occur. That's where the energies are derived from. So when they talk about starting the machine, you have to keep in mind that there are multiple machines leading up to and accelerating particles into the main ring. The dates that I'm going to provide to you are focused on the main ring, not the other machines leading up to it. These dates come from their published public calendar. You can go to my website, anthonypatch.com. Go to the top, click on the tab Images 2. It will then show you an image of one of the detectors, an image many people have seen. Looks like the sun, looks like Shiva. You click on that picture, it will open the link to the PDF. You can open the PDF and look at the calendar. I'll tell you right now, it's confusing. You have to go all the way to the very beginning of the calendar and look at the specific dates, because the heading of the month on the top of the calendar is shifted to the left. Meaning, if you take the month and go down the line into the dates, the block of dates and weeks, it'll throw you off. So, anyway, just carefully examine it. Let me give you some dates. This is on my homepage of my website. March 25th, not the 23rd, not the 20th, not the 13th, not the 15th. Those are all misreadings of what machine are we talking about and when is it starting. Again, main ring, these are the dates. March 25th, the main ring will be commissioned. I'll define that. Commissioning means they've gone through all of the injection testing, sending beams around in one direction only, and then in two directions opposing, without collisions, without the crossover, inside the detectors taking place. Just circulating beams going around. When they say we're going to commission the beam on the 25th, the main ring is now clean, it's now cold, and it has circulated successfully confined, defined streams of particles without any strain of the beam to the inner walls of the tubular ring itself. They have a clean process. And I'll stop there in case you have questions, and I'll go on to the dates and the energy levels in a moment.
Well, I'm fine.
Now, in the main collider, does it have, in the main collider, I've seen this where it crosses and everything on the video, but does it have like four rings? Does the main collider have four rings that it swirls around at one time?
Now, you're speaking of the last accelerator, the last small ring synchrotron accelerator has a stack of four rings on top of one another. This then combines into two streams going in opposite directions. Remember I talked about the beam lines that radiate out from the synchrotron machines? These are essentially two beam lines coming off of this stack of four small ringed synchrotron, and they then take from that those two streams and circulate it in the main single layer, single tube main ring. So the main ring is like the an inflatable inner tube in a tire. One inner tube. The one just before that had four inner tubes stacked on top of one another.
Okay. So I'm just thinking about the four souls of Horus and becoming two and then becoming one, but that might not have anything to do with it. But just interesting how it has the four and then it has the two and then it has... Why does it do that?
Well, you have to have the ability to accelerate progressively these particles. And so it's like a... what's the best way to put it? It's a compounding of the acceleration. So you have the ability to take one ring and accelerate to an energy level and then compound that energy level as you go up through the stacks of rings to where you can finally take that maximum power of all four rings combined and inject that into the main ring.
Okay, and so after it's in the main ring, what happens after that?
Well, to date, there have not been any collisions that have taken place in the main ring. They're trying to keep it clean, therefore they're not performing those collisions. They've done low-power testing collisions. I should back up a little bit. Very low power test just to calibrate the detectors. But when they go to full commission, that means the tube is clean of the particles, zero energy, and a temperature that is lower than outer space itself. And that means they're ready for collisions to take place at higher levels. Now, those higher level collisions, the first date, and I'm going to define dates now. We defined collisions, we defined commissioning. Now, when we talk about the dates on the calendar, if you go to that PDF, you will see that there are what I call blocks of dates. You're not having a collision take place on one day as a single occurrence. You are seeing anywhere from 10 days to 2 weeks to 3 weeks as blocks of experiments that are taking place with different types of particles. And therefore, when I'm citing these dates to you, these are the beginning points of a block of dates and a block of experiments contained within those blocks of dates, okay? You guys with me?
Yeah. I wanted to ask,
sure.
So the block of dates that you're talking about, this is when you talked about commissioning, and then this is where they're going to do the, they call it the beam. Is this the beam test, or what do you call it?
Well, they've done the beam tests, and some of this is defined on their calendar. They'll have labels on there where these things are pointed out. But the commissioning was testing of the beam, doing some low-level and then progressively higher-level collisions, but they're nothing close to the types of energies I'm going to cite that will start in June. Okay?
Okay. All right. Maybe it's too early for me to ask this question. Did you want to continue with what's going to go on June 1st before we add? I wanted to ask about earthquakes, but do you want to hold off on that one?
Yeah, let's hold off on that. We can bring that back just to maintain some continuity of the timing, because the media focuses on dates and starting times, alternative media as well as mainstream. So when we're talking about something that is going to generate high levels of energy, energy higher than what they achieved prior to the emergency shutdown that we mentioned earlier, June 17th. June 17th is when they will have an intensity ramp up, and I want you to focus on that, intensity ramp up. This is what is going on throughout the year leading up to the end of the year. I won't go into the machinery of it because I covered it before, but suffice it to say that they are stair-stepping up in their intensity of the speed at which the particles are colliding, as well as the ramping up of the energies that they will derive from these collisions. June 17th, they will achieve 17 TeV. That's tera electron volts. Tera meaning trillion. So you have 17 trillion electron volts that will be achieved at the beginning of this block of time and block of experiments that will continue ramping up from 17 to higher and higher levels of energy. Let me back up. I'm sorry. I apologize to my audience. 7 TeV, not 17. 7 TeV will be the starting point on June 17th. That's where my crossover for me was. June 17th, 7 TeV will be the starting point of the ramping up of energy, increasing in their intensity to July 24th. July 24th, they will achieve, again, a starting point of a new block of experiments in a new block of weeks, 13 TeV. Now, what is critical within 13 TeV is that they will move from 7 to 13, crossing a threshold at 10. 10 TeV is the threshold at which strangelets are produced, and they will be produced within the ALIS detector. So I'm not trying to overload people. I want to just stop there before I go to the next date. But again, we are talking about a ramping up of power, but I want to define what it means by 10 TeV, trillion, seven trillion tera electron volts. That is actually the mass of the particle. Now follow me on this, because this is a little bit, you know, a little bit difficult for some people who've never read this before. This is a inverting of Einstein's theory or equation that everybody is familiar with, E equals mc squared. They are now taking E equals mc squared. They're taking the E at the beginning and replacing it with the M, which is mass. You now have M equals E C squared. C is the speed of light squared. M is mass. E is energy. They have reversed the process. What I'm getting at here is that you can take a particle and accelerate it to 99.99% the speed of light, but it doesn't matter how much more energy, electrical energy, that you put behind that particle you're accelerating, because you can never, according to Einstein's theory of relativity, you can never exceed the speed of light with mass, with a particle, with a solid object. But they will continue to accelerate these even though they know they cannot exceed the speed of light. What's the point here? The point is, the more energy you pump into a particle, you can never accelerate it faster. You reach a sound barrier, if you will, or a light barrier. The energy you're pumping into that particle in an attempt to accelerate it causes the particle to expand, to gain in mass. The tera electron volts is a representation of the increased mass of the particles. These particles are becoming heavier and denser the more energy that the main ring, the accelerator, is providing to it. They are creating particles that have never existed in nature. The energy that is derived from those collisions is higher than has ever existed, as created by man. They are replicating the energies that come from a black hole. They are replicating the energy that is emanating in the form of a burst, or a burster, as it is called in astronomy, synchrotron energies that emanate, that radiate in two opposite directions out of a black hole. I need to stop, because I'm sure you need to digest and ask questions, and we can go back over this if you need to. But I have one more date to go. Go ahead.
What's this mass particle called? Is it just, it's not the Higgs particle, is it?
No.
This is a different type of particle.
Well, the particle itself does not change. What they're accelerating amongst many, and I'll keep it very simple, because there's a list of about 12 different types of particles that they actually will be colliding this year. Protons are being collided, and then protons with other particles are being collided. Later this year, they will use ions of lead, which they have used in conjunction with protons, but they will take lead and circulate it in opposite directions and smash lead together. They're not creating new particles, they're just creating particles that have greater mass. So they're taking energy and converting it to mass. When you look at an atomic bomb, an atomic bomb is creating energy by splitting mass. Here we have the combining, if you will, or the increasing of mass to create energy. Again, the inverse of E equals mc squared.
So this is like a reversal effect of energy, kind of like a magnetic force?
Certainly.
And is it interesting that they use a muon in the machine, which is the identical word of Venus, and it ties into the phosphorus and the Hebrew letter of the Mem. I find that just really so interesting. Mm-hmm. And not only that, Mars, which Venus is, that to me is their kind of like counterparts. And through mythology and, you know, the resurrection of Osiris with Isis and Thoth and as Horus is connected. You know, Mars and Venus are mm-hmm. connected to each other, and Venus, you know, represents Lucifer. But I just find that interesting. You know, Mars is made out of iron, and they're going to use that, mm-hmm. and then they're using the muons, which is connected to what Venus is made out of. So they're using what Venus is made out of, and they're using what Mars is made out of. And so I just find that very fascinating connection to mm-hmm. to all of this. But when they make this big bang, in my mind, I can't think, is this like something they're doing that comes out of the center of this ring, or is this something that is below that's going to come from above? I mean, this bang, where does it, I mean, how do they do it, and where does it come from? I mean, what happens to that?
Sure. Let's go back to our analogy of the inflatable inner tube for a tire. Within that inner tube, you have the circulating beams that are held to the center of that circle. So if you look at a cross-section of the inner tube, it's a circle. In the center of the circle is the beam that is circulating. The reason that the beam stays in the circle is because of the magnets. The magnets are creating energy to confine those beams. Again, go back to Ghostbusters, confine the stream. That's what they're doing with the magnets, is confining what would ordinarily be a beam that would just scatter particles all through the inside of the inner tube. So inside that inner tube, you have four major locations that have detectors. And these are the things that you see the pictures of when people put up photographs of CERN and these elaborate radial or circular arrayed devices. That's the cross-section of the detectors. The detectors are multiples of detectors arrayed in a circle, all focused towards the center point. The center point of the detector is where the beam passes through. So you have a very, very small, let's call it a hair follicle diameter beam going through your rubber inner tube. And at different points, four different points, or more than that, but four major detectors like the ALICE detector that have the ability to allow those two streams of beams, two opposite circulating beams that normally would just pass by each other. Okay? Within, go back to the cross-section of the inner tube. Instead of one beam, you have two because they're circulating and they're going by one another, but at some point they cross over. So you have two inner tubes, and I know I may be confusing people, but you have two inner tubes, two beams within what is called the main ring. At some point you take the two inner tubes and you cross them over, allowing the beam within each inner tube to strike one another. And that's where the collision occurs within the detector, in the center point of the detector. And they're much like cameras. That's an easy way to define or describe this array of detectors. It's like you're taking photographs of the particles and the energy, but the particles specifically in those wild patterns of colors and different patterns of trajectories of these particles. You're seeing photographs, and that's a simplistic description, but photographs of those particles after the collision occurs inside the detector.
So it's like a spark.
Exactly.
And this is what they call the Big Bang, the spark. And we, yes. You know, on one of our shows, we talked about the spark and how it's the Zayin letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and it's the fourth shin. And the Jews, they were the Teflon, and they call that fourth shin the new world to come. And the Pope is looking for the spiritual
particle.
And I mean, I can't understand why anyone wouldn't question or wonder why he would be asking for that. And, you know, we're living in some interesting times. I mean, he has said that it's dangerous to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and he has said some really off the wall things. You know, he would baptize an alien, and, you know, lots of crazy things that they say going on. I can't understand, you know, why Time Magazine put out if he's so popular and, you know, so many people follow him. And you know, because the Bible clearly tells us that we're not to follow man or worship any idols, that we are to only follow God. So I just find that interesting that that he is calling out for that, and he is going to address Congress on the 24th, which is the same month that is going to be very interesting, because you'll go on with the dates, but that's a very important date that's going to be escalated at that time. So.
That's right.
What's the next date we're looking at? You said you were in June?
17th.
Yeah. I'll go back again. March 25th, the commissioning of the beam. So now it's ready for its first collisions, or high-level collisions. June 17th, they will achieve, in their higher collisions, they will achieve 7 TeV, which is higher than the machine, almost double the power of what they achieved in 2012, where it was 4 TeV. So we're looking at 7 now. July 24th, we will see 13 TeV. November 20th, they will achieve 14. Now, let me back up a little bit to September, because it does operate, it does have collisions occurring in the month of September. It just won't be up to 14 TeV at that point. It could. Again, I have to couch things a little bit, because they're not revealing everything in public in terms of the power levels and the dates of those power levels. But starting in September, October, and November, September, October, November, they will be colliding ions of lead particles, lead-to-lead collisions in the main ring. So their highest power they're shooting for in September, and certainly continuing, again, blocks of experiments all the way out almost to Christmas. And they will be shutting down just prior to Christmas.
So
September, absolutely. Go ahead.
So this colliding of lead particles, is this tied in any way to the famous alchemical changing lead to gold concept?
Certainly it does. This is all hermetic. You've seen in my videos that I've produced, my little slideshow things, I've showed the image of the tablet of Hermes, the green emerald tablet that goes back to the Wizard of Oz and the green emerald city, all of that occultic stuff. But yes, lead to gold, there was an article came out last year. It was rather sort of tongue-in-cheek by the scientific authors of the articles. But they were saying openly, yes, we have converted lead into gold at CERN. And some people in the audience may have heard that story. These are microscopic particles of gold. I think people need to appreciate that. But yes, we are actually talking about the age-old alchemic goal of turning lead into gold. Is that the purpose of the collisions of the lead-to-lead particles? No. It's a spin-off. It really doesn't have that much to do with anything. But it does demonstrate that they are achieving tremendous amounts of power that can go to the quantum level and redefine the structure at the quantum level of an atom. And therefore, you can manipulate at the quantum level the quantum particles and create any type of atom that you choose. They can create gold and create silver and create anything on the periodic table and then beyond the periodic table, because they do have, with these higher energies, the ability to manipulate the particles, the structure of our atoms. So when we talk about muons, gluons, quarks, boson, Higgs boson, we're talking about shifting those around using the building blocks to create whatever you want.
Yeah. I had talked to Chris, and I was bugging her earlier this week, going, you got to see this video by the Osbournes, Ozzy Osbourne and Black Sabbath. His oldest daughter just released her first video called Raining Gold, and it's an apocalyptic scene, and she's walking around as everybody's dying. And we got into the tears of Anubis being gold. And so I was going, what is all this crazy Egyptian Anubis raining gold? Where is this coming from? And here we are slamming lead together and creating gold. And the tears of Anubis or something. I mean, this is the wild kind of weird connections we're making. But Hollywood is cranking out this stuff because they know what's in the pipeline. And that I'll just
right start. And all these things are interconnected. There's so much complexity to the interweaving of all of these things that in the science realm, the reason for the lead to lead is because of the density of lead. And if the denser the particle, stripped of its electrons, creating an ion of lead, the higher the energy that you can achieve. That's a simple explanation. So they're taking what we have as the heaviest particles, slamming them together, and therein lies the power that they need to establish a portal, a fixed portal, a permanent portal at the 14 plus tera electron volt level. You now have lead that has 14 times its resting mass. Resting mass is when it is not accelerated, it's at rest, there's no energy imparted on it to cause it to move. It is now 14 times heavier because of the energy that has been pushed or pumped into it to accelerate it to 99.99% the speed of light. Again, you are creating mass by using the energy from those collisions. So it's a little confusing, but easy way to say it is we've tried it with the lighter particles, the protons, and then up through another dozen or so other particles, getting certain things that they want out of those intermediate collisions throughout the year. But the goal is let's open that portal. And they know now what type of energy they need. They know that because of what happened in 2012.
So this brings up the whole blacksmith imagery of me, the big hammer and the anvil and the sparks flying from the connection between the objects between the hammer and the anvil and this slamming together of things to generate this kind of spark. But we're creating mass, so what happens with mass, though? It's not energy, it's mass. Now we get, that's weird.
That is. It is. And that's where it gets a little bit murky for me, because I'm not quite sure what they intend to do with this other than I go back to my strangelets again, and it's kind of the drum that I keep beating, but they are creating strangelets at that intermediate level of 10 tera electron volts, which occurs July 24th. Strangelets are produced at 10 TeV. I believe that they are creating in tandem with this increase in mass of the lead particles, they're creating more strangelets. This is a ramping up of the production of strangelets. That's the quick summation of what they're doing in tandem with opening the portal. Because you cannot escape the fact that the strangelets are being produced. It was proven last year, published in August of last year, Brookhaven Laboratory, using their muon magnet, they accelerated and briefly achieved 10 TeV and created some small quantities of strangelets. that was a proof of concept test, proof of concept experiment, that they took that process and transferred it to the Large Hadron Collider. And CERN will never admit to the title of strangelets. They always talk about they are, yes, creating a condensate of quark gluons within the ALICE detector, but they will not hang the name strangelet on it because they fear the same media backlash that they got when people were talking about the creation of microscopic black holes with the collider. And everybody, including Hawking, was up in arms about black holes being created, and he's right. They are creating black holes, but they're microscopic and they tend to wink out of existence very quickly. Now, at these higher energy levels, yes, there is the possibility of black holes, but they will not use the name strangelets because of the backlash that they will get when people start saying strangelets are like black holes. I call them the cousin to the black hole because they're heavy and dense like a black hole, but they don't have that density and that gravity that a black hole have. But they attract energy and they attract light and they attract atoms to themselves like a black hole does. And I need to stop there.
Okay, I wanted to say a couple things on what you're saying, and then, you know, first what Tim was talking about with Ozzy Osbourne's daughter, you know, putting out that song, and there's some other things that have come out about Tears of Gold. But in ancient history, I guess the Sumerians, they were gold miners, and throughout my research, I'm to understand that they did this so that way they could move through the dimensions, and they used some type of breakdown of the gold. They break it down in so many levels, but and they use these masks. That's why Anubis wore the dog mask that had gold in it, and they would travel to Mars, is what a lot of the texts say. But there's a few interesting connections with that, because when Obama did his Obamacare commercial, and you know, he did the all mocking tongue on that, but he drew a picture of a Nakeda woman. And Nakeda people had blue eyes. A lot of the gods, like Quetzalcoatl, had blue eyes. And a lot of the, if you look at blue-eyed gods, you'll see them. But I just find that interesting because the gold made their eyes turn blue when they were traveling through the dimensions. And that's just some things that I've researched. But I just find that so interesting. You know, these songs are coming out, and then you can read about the Tears of Anubis being gold, and some just weird commercials coming out about how do we see this, like one person sees one color and one sees another, and they're doing some really weird things right now. But just interesting that you said that there was gold, and I know the planets, all the planets are made out of different elements. Gold, Earth has the four elements, and then different planets have different elements. And then Thoth, of course, represents Mercury. He's Hermes, and he's the trickster, and he is the specialist in the Hermetics, and he has all the books and the text on that. He represents the number 8, and, you know, there's a Bible verse about the 7 and the 8 that we talked about on Face Like the Sun video. But yeah, I mean, it's just so interesting, all of these things that are connected with each other. But I wanted to point that out, and then I wanted to ask you about the quantum computer, because I'm so confused about CERN, and then we have this quantum computer, and they're able to put these phosphorus atoms, and we know Venus is made out of phosphorus, and there's a breakdown of gold in that, but If this planet's made out of that and they're putting these phosphorus atoms into the quantum computer, there's some type of connection with CERN and the quantum computer. I just don't understand really what it is. Do you know anything about that?
Sure. Let me back up just a little bit to the gold just for a moment. Remember I talked about the third strand of DNA and that third strand being coated in a nano-thin coating of gold. And the purpose of that gold in that third strand application is for the imparting or the digitizing of information into the DNA. So when you say about the mask and you talk about the tears, you're talking about the transformation, the genetic manipulation. And we see a lot of the deities as chimera, the mixing of the animal and human form. And therefore, the gold represents that process of genetic manipulation comprised of the third strand of DNA, which is the alien DNA, which will be utilized in the resurrection of the beast, which is something we'll get into a little bit later. But to go back to phosphorus, you're talking essentially phosphorus is one of what they call quantum dots. Quantum dots are luminous. They are like a, when you use luminous paint, like at Halloween and things like that for costumes, the glow-in-the-dark paints. Luminous glow-in-the-dark paints are quantum dots at the quantum level that are used to identify different subatomic particles at the quantum level so that they're easier to track and easier to model, especially when they're using high-powered X-rays like at Berkeley with the synchrotron to create protein models. So the phosphorus ties right back into DNA genetic manipulation. All of that is handled by the quantum computer. The quantum computer is tied to CERN not only in the processing of digital information to control the portal, but also once the portal is open to the control of the spirits coming to and then imparting those spirits onto bodies, onto host bodies. Now this gets into the deception, the physicists believing they're going to become immortal gods. Some of them believe that they are going to be possessed by these spirits so that they will achieve godlike immortality. But also in previous videos we've talked about the creation of hybrids that are waiting to be hosts, to be receptacles for these incoming spirits. So the adiabatic quantum computer has multiple applications depending on the time frame of what's going on with the machine. So you have it controlling the machine, you have it controlling the opening of the portal, you have it controlling the conduit from Saturn of these energies, these spirits coming through the portal into our dimension. And then you have the ability to create a beast from genetic manipulation of artificial three-strand DNA, creating the image of the beast and controlling that image, because this will be artificial, it will be holographic. It won't be a laser projection, but it is holographic in the sense that it is a computer-generated, grown from three-strand artificial DNA, human figure. The human figure, there was an article came out today in which the author was saying the smashing of particles together will merge spirit and physics, spirit and physical, creating a beast. That's very simplistic. I've just explained to you the more sophisticated process that is taking place, and that's the genetic manipulation and growing of that DNA using the quantum computer to do that, to create this new beast, and the computer will control that beast. Go ahead.
I think that's what I will witness in the Transcendence movie, where the computers use the nanotechnology to construct the biology or the biological DNA stranded bodies. In that movie, I've said to my audience forever. The movie Transcendence is the most obvious 666 beast movie I've ever seen, using the adiabatic computer technology. Also, the main character is shot by a bullet, which is, but the bullet is nuclear also, which makes me think on that sometimes. But the point is that he dies from this. This consciousness is downloaded into this computer. AI is achieved. He reconstructs his body over time as they reverse engineer all of physics, of the known world physics using these computers, until he creates his own body and then re-downloads his consciousness. A Ray Kurzweil beast. What do you want to call it? It's the just watching the thing. It's just it's the image of the beast. It's the beast creating itself holographically, and it's the beast the downloading consciousness. So what you're talking about here with this three-strand DNA bodies, host bodies for these spirits, is just another version of downloading consciousness into these avatars, the movie Avatar.
Yeah. Yep, exactly. And I don't want to step on Chris, but just to complete the thought, yes, definitely, these are avatars that will receive the spirits. When you talk about biology, again, we have to define biology in a new way. Biology, when we think of biology in the common high school and college level biology courses that we've taken, we think of things that grow from nature, things that grow from cells, from mitochondria. Okay. You go to the quantum level, you are now moving out of the standard model of physics and biology to the quantum level, where the standard model does not apply. Therefore, you have new rules, new things that govern the behavior of those building block quantum particles, like the Higgs boson. Okay? When we define biology in the framework of quantum physics or quantum studies, we have to call it quantum biology, because you are creating a new form of biology. You are taking the quantum particles, the building blocks, that create the proteins, that create the mitochondria, that create the cells that grow. So if you start with the building blocks, you go to the chemicals, you go to the elements, and you manipulate those at that level and stack the blocks differently, you create a new biology, you create a new life form, and that life form begins to grow. Now, does it have a spirit? Does it have, is it something of God? Does it have a soul? Does it have a consciousness? That's a different discussion, but focusing on the process, we're looking at creating new biology. Remember a few weeks ago we had the gentleman who was talking about this very process, the doctor who was at NASA Ames talking to the other physicists back in 2009,
they were Venter. Talking. Yeah, Venter, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Craig Venter. This is what we have to do: is define biology in the new world of quantum studies. Go ahead,
Chris. You want to chime in, or do you, yeah, I had some more questions on it. Okay. I mean, as far as what I try to do is connect what people are watching on TV. The same topic is being played out right now in the Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. storyline with this Sky character with this new evolved DNA. And that's what they keep showing, the DNA helical strand, the activated chromosomes that have not been activated before, the holes in the DNA. And I think Anthony is talking about the third strand DNA with the gold as being the what they're selling as the activation of those, you know, turned off, you know. They try to say it's turned off DNA, the alien DNA, the panspermia DNA. That's what
right.
We're going from Darwinian evolution into panspermia. That's where they jumped off into panspermia. And now we're doing directed evolution with basically a gun to Darwin's head. And that's the way I'm kind of simplistically defining it. But this is interesting. Quantum biology is not something I'm familiar. Now that you've said it, they're reconstructing at the quantum level biology, and you have to redefine biology as quantum biology.
That's right. That's right. And I'm glad you bring up panspermia. That's in my first book, Covert Catastrophe. I go into that quite a bit. I relate it to Ray Kurzweil. I relate it to Dr. Stephen Hawking. I'm glad Hawking's coming around. In my first book, I'm a little hard on him, but I'm glad that he's coming around to understanding that God exists and God's the creator. I don't want to put words in his mouth, but but I do think that's the direction he's going. But in that, I talk about panspermia, and to define that again, we're talking about the theory that we come from the stars, that somehow on meteors, on asteroids, there were our DNA, keeping it simple, our DNA was on these moving bodies that collided with Earth and therefore started life on Earth. And I'm sorry, I don't buy into it. Is it possible? Is it probable? Is it of God? Could it be a process that God created? Sure, why not? I mean, we can go there if you need to, but that's what panspermia is, and it is directed evolution by man now. That most definitely, this is where we're at. We're at directed evolution.
Well, I just wanted to mention that we've done shows on this too, but the Caduceus of Hermes is in the Unicode as a protein DNA of the rhesus monkey. So the Caduceus of Hermes, which is all tied into this, and he is the alchemist, mm-hmm. and we're talking about this tied in with CERN, but his Caduceus represents DNA. It represents the tree in the garden of good, of knowledge and good and evil, of consciousness. The Bible actually says consciousness, that's the real term. Mm-hmm. There's a tree of immortality and a tree of consciousness. There's two trees, and Adam and Eve took on the tree of consciousness, and that's, you know, the way it is. But they want the Garden of Eden with the tree of consciousness. They can't have the immortality. They can't have both trees. You know, they want the Garden of Eden and to sin and to be in this paradise. And they can't have all this, but that's what their goal is. That's why Satan wants to be God. But it is very interesting, you know, that Hermes represents the Sumerian god that is the snake guarding the tree. And that's written in text that can be confirmed. But the connection with Mercury and Thoth and carrying the Caduceus and the tree in the garden, and it being in the Unicode, I think it's 2695 is one of them. There's a few of them, but interesting that is one of the connections into all of this. I mean, CERN is connected with all of the gods in mythology. It's connected to Atlas. It's connected to, there's an Aleph detector that we've talked about, the Aleph symbol being the plow and the plowshares and the first and last letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And it's tied in with Ceres and with the mythological characters. I mean, it's all tied to CERN. I mean, all of it is. And it's very easy to see, but you know, people don't have the time to really look into all of this information. They have jobs and families and, you know, there's, you know, TV and the internet, all these distractions that are purposely put into their face, you know, from Project Paperclip, from creating the television to all of these things for people not to realize until when do they realize that this is a very serious thing, that CERN is basically, I mean, even Stephen Hawking, like you said, he's waking up and realizing this is a very dangerous thing, and it does have to do with the end times, and it is connected to the universe and the planets and the celestial realms. They tie these things all in to that with alchemy to bring in the Antichrist. And so I just wanted to point that out about the DNA and the Caduceus and the Unicode.
Let's go back to Ceres for a moment. Cernunnos, Ceres, CERN. Go ahead.
No, I see the connection. I definitely, this thing went into orbit, you remember, on a date that was a 666 date into the orbit of Ceres. It's going to be there for, they said, a year and a half. The politics of CERN is that we hear about our climate catastrophe as of September, that the politicians have said, and then the Pope showing up the next day. And then we just talked about, so we got Ceres, and we got Cernunnos. And then our question that we're putting out there, of course, is what is the astronomical connection of September, the TEVs, and the connection to Saturn? And that's one of the problems we're trying to work out with the plasma helical conduit concept that we're starting to talk about. And my other question was, with the reaching the 10 TeV, the strangelet creation, and the mass creation stuff that we're talking about, again, I'll relate this back to Superman. The reason that our little Superman had to leave Krypton was because something was happening to the core of that planet.
So, you know, I'm so glad we have our own form of the Trinity here.
Yeah. I'm more the comic relief, I think.
No, this is beautiful, but you are right. Okay, so let me define for the audience. Strangelets, not only their capability to attract other atoms to themselves is one of their crossovers to black holes, but they are the heaviest particles known. Are we losing Chris?
Oh. No. I lost my pen. I try to write things down so I don't lose my train of thought. Go ahead.
Anyway, they attract atoms to themselves, but they're also the heaviest known particles, and they are artificial. They're created at the Large Hadron Collider. And because they are so heavy, they, quote, fall to the center of the Earth. Now, relating to the Superman story, the planet Krypton, that could be, you know, predictive programming if you want. But strangelets, when they go to the core of the planet, depending on the number of strangelets, the quantity of strangelets that go to the core, will determine the time frame for the potential, I underscore, emphasize potential, conversion of the planet at some point to a neutron star. Now, this is in the open internet information. This isn't anything I'm making up. The point here is that when CERN fires off in September, October, November at their highest energy level, 14 TeV. Does that mean we're going to convert the planet to a neutron star? No. I want to emphasize that. No. They could create sufficient quantities over a certain period of time to achieve that conversion to a neutron star of the planet if that was their goal. But in my estimation, we're looking at something that could take as long as 100 years. For that conversion to take place. Now, I'm going to jump back to Tim wanting to talk about earthquakes. Definitely, strangelets can cause earthquakes. They cause it because of the attraction of material, the planet material, the atoms at the core, attracting that to themselves and exponentially growing in size within the core. So you are, if you want, consuming material, it's eating the planet from the inside out, to put it in a strange form. If you're going to do that, if you're going to convert the planet, obviously it's going to have repercussions on the surface, on the crust, on the tectonic structure of the planet. And the planet's already expanding because of the increasing energies that the core is receiving. In the model of the electric universe, we're seeing earthquakes right now because the planet is growing in size. It's expanding and separating the tectonic plates. They're not subducting, they're expanding. The strangelets can cause an increase in earthquakes. The other thing that is already causing an increase in earthquakes are the magnets themselves within CERN. And there's a direct correlation between the time frames in which they have previously brought their magnets, their superconducting magnets, up to full power back in 2012, 2011, 2010. we saw significant earthquakes, meaning 6.5, 7.0s, and 8s, corresponding either on the day or the day after the activation of the magnets within CERN. That's very controversial, but certainly within the framework of what they're doing, there's a direct correlation. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just trying to relate it back to Matthew 24 and what we're talking about here with the when the disciples are talking about what are the signs of your coming, and we have the increase in earthquakes in diverse places. And here we got CERN with its high mass of, I mean, they didn't, Jesus didn't say watch out for CERN, because it's really going to crank up some serious energy and going to rattle the whole planet. And on the, you know, but we're looking at CERN as being connected to some of these end time events. And I just wanted to see how we tied it in with earthquakes, that much energy. And if we got into the whole concept of terraforming, which is a controversial kind of thing, but that's what we were talking about with the ion star. And of course that would shake things up.
One of the questions is what are they trying to achieve here in the big picture, the ultimate goal, where are we going with this whole thing? Let's go to the video. What was the video from CERN with the dancing? What was that called?
Symmetry.
Symmetry. Thank you. In symmetry, they show, and one of the guys out there is doing a great job of showing what and taking apart in that video and showing what's going on. What's his name again? The website we've been looking at. Is it face like
round
the sun?
Round Saturn's Eye.
Round Saturn's Eye. Excellent work. Excellent work on symmetry. The point here is in that video they show desolation. They show the dry lake bed. They show the circle. They show the dancer within the circle. The circle is, you know, of course it's going to be the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, but we're talking about big picture. The desolation, go to Shiva, go to the Hindu god, the statue at CERN. There's a lot of reasons for that, but one of the things we need, again, we're defining a lot of things today. Let's define Shiva. Shiva is well known as the god of destroyer, of destruction. That's what everybody's talking about. However, she is also the one that creates desolation. Desolation translated to a clean sheet of paper, starting over, starting from scratch. Again, quantum biology, going to the physics of what's going on when you collide these particles. You are starting with the Big Bang within the machine, the point of the creation of the universe. The dance is replicating that within symmetry, that desolation of the dry lake bed. Destroy the planet, destroy what we have, start over with a clean sheet of paper, and create a new Garden of Eden, a new heaven on Earth, through their physics and through their quantum biology, and through the new beings, the new race of beings that will inhabit this new terraformed planet that they're trying to create. It's all in that video. It's in our face.
Can I ask you another question regarding what you just defined? In Mark chapter 13, verse 14, it says, "But when you see the abomination of desolation standing where it should not be, then head for the mountains."
Yeah. Head to Petra.
Connection?
Let's go to Petra. Yeah, that's the holographic beast. That's the beast that they're creating. And the desolation is all in Scripture. I mean, this is all crossing over to each frame of reference. So ultimately, the big picture, what they're trying to do is they're trying to create heaven on earth. They're trying to kill God, trying to kill God's angels. This is the Battle of Armageddon. They are trying to start over, and I love to use this word, and I'm going to use it again, hubris.
We need T-shirts with you. With you have hubris on there, you know, or something.
Hey, I was just going to mention that also, you know, NASA has that Comet 67P, you know, that they landed on.
Yeah.
And they name each part of that comet after a Egyptian god.
Yeah.
They break it all down, and each piece of it is a different name of an Egyptian god, and I just find that interesting. I mean, we know that they're based off of JPL, which we've talked about before. They said they were connected to the nine, you know, the council that they connect to in a different dimension. So, you know, just another interesting fact, you know. How is NASA connected to CERN?
Well, again, NASA does a lot of the preliminary legwork for CERN in terms of research and development and machinery, and NASA's tied in with the Department of Energy, which essentially is the administrator for all of these colliders, these labs all over the United States. But NASA, obviously, they're focused on what's going on in the big picture out in the cosmos, and they're all about Jupiter and Saturn, and they know full well what is going on. And you look at all of the occult symbology, symbolism that they use in their mission patches on the astronauts' uniforms and that they put on their websites. All of this stuff is tied into the occult. NASA is nothing more than an occult research entity that is taking the spiritual and merging it with the physical. All of this, when we talk about, I'm going off on a tangent, when you talk about Egyptian gods and you talk about the comet, we talk about all of these different ancient entities, they represent physical particles. You talk about a god that represents iron. You have a direct connection between spiritual and physical. The spiritual in the form of gods, entities, symbolism, physics in the form of the periodic table of elements. The two are connected. Why do they hang all of these occult names and labels and symbols and statues on a physical machine or on spacecraft at NASA and satellites and probes? Because the two are connected. They play off each other. They work off each other. They have to have each other. You cannot look at the world and our universe and our frame of reference solely through the eyes of physics or solely through the eyes of spiritual. You have to merge the two. When we talk about waking people up, we're waking them up to this, the merging of physics, what we call our reality, what we can touch, and what we cannot touch, which is the spiritual. And until people understand that they have to take in the spiritual component of this, the occult spiritual as well as our Christian beliefs in the spiritual, and pull the two together. If you want to smash particles together, if you want to collide something, in your head you have to collide those two frames of reference to our world, spiritual and physical.
Mm-hmm. The problem is they believe in the wrong spiritual. I mean, that's all the occult religion, the cabalistry and the planets and the spirits they connect to. I mean, that's the conscious level, you know, that they're connecting to. And the trick of the matter is that, you know, how Satan says, surely you won't die, but you will, because you won't be alive, because Jesus said that those who are not in him are walking dead men. They're already walking around dead. They don't have the Holy Spirit, and the only thing that we need is the Holy Spirit of the one true God, not all of these other things that they want to get people to believe, because that's why he's the trickster. He's the trickster because he's many different faces and, you know, many different gods and, all these religions have been created all over the world to confuse people, and this Freemasonry and, you know, all these things that have been in you know, with these secret societies from the very beginning. You know, it's a lot to research. It's a lot of confusion that they've caused into the world, a lot of deception and a lot of confusion. I mean, there's a lot of people that preach that do witchcraft behind the scenes that are white witches. I mean, there's a lot of people that preach that they don't they might talk about Jesus and they might preach the word, because even Satan, you know, he knows the word of God. But they don't lead people to Christ or invite people into the kingdom of God. There's so much.
It's dangerous to have a relationship with Christ, though, Chris. That's what the Pope told me. So, you know, he told me it's dangerous. So.
Well, we don't listen to believe him. We believe Jesus.
Thank you.
That's right. Now, let's shift gears a little bit, okay? Let's change the energy up a little bit. Tomorrow is the eclipse, right?
Oh, yeah.
All right, so go forth with that. Go forth with it.
Well, I advertised for SLU. They're not Christian or anything like that, but the point was, I always enjoy those guys. They had their camera set up out of the Canary Islands, and SLU's going to have a solar eclipse event tomorrow, which I believe is the... Everybody who's watching the four tetrad moons, this is the third event, and so that will be tomorrow, 4:30 Eastern time, if you want to see it on slooh.com, and hopefully we don't crash their servers, and that's the main thing with that. But it should be interesting, and if you're not able to see it, I'm sure there'll be plenty of replays of the moment of the full. I forget how many minutes the full they were saying it the other day. I was watching it when they were having that magnetic storm that came down from the poles, and they were up there, and it was like standing underneath the shower, the head of the shower,
yeah.
Watching the aurora borealis just light up.
Let me stop you there. Wait until we talked about the magnets and the magnetosphere. Okay. You think you saw some northern lights. Wait until they open up the magnetosphere and the magnetopause, which is out further, when they connect to Saturn with this plasma conduit. It's going to light up the whole planet in northern lights.
Wow. You mean it's going to be really just wild looking, just the difference of... So everybody's being exposed to high levels of radiation then at that time, right?
Because you're gonna open the shower curtain. There's your shower head. Let's go to the shower curtain. You open the shower curtain, and now you're going to be bombarded by everything that we've been protected by our shields from the sun and from other areas in the solar system. The energy that normally we don't encounter. Gamma rays and covert catastrophe. The opening of my book is Markarian 421.
Yeah.
Black hole, a burster, gamma rays. First time Earth directed at that highest energy level. That's exactly what we're talking about. Gamma ray energy coming in through the shields and affecting us.
As far as this event, what are you expecting to see with this? I know we're in March. We saw DEF CON 3 this week. Was reported. We're back to DEF CON 4. Okay, I checked it out with no explanation. Major mobilization of Russian troops all over creation, and major grandstanding by the United States moving their things around. As we approach CERN 10 TeV, are we just going to be bombarded with nonstop distractions, or are we going to be watching blood sacrifices to their gods at CERN as they open these new energies, or what?
Wow. Okay. Let's see. I'm going to answer that by saying, in Scripture, we are compelled to keep our eyes on Israel. that Israel is the timepiece for what will play out in God's plan as presented in Scripture. So as we watch the re-election of Netanyahu this week, and we see the threat of Iran and our government's involvement in setting up a treaty relative to their nuclear program in Iran, and the existential threat that poses to the existence of Israel, I'll throw it right out. I think we will see at least Isaiah, and we will see not Ezekiel 38 and 39, that comes later, but we are going to see the destruction of Damascus overnight. We are going to see a major Middle East conflict take place with Israel fighting its immediate surrounding or in Scripture compassed nations surrounding Israel. That's Syria, that's Jordan. Right now, Jordan's kind of our friend, their friend, but Jordan's on there. Iraq, Saudi Arabia, Egypt. We have those countries right now directly involved with Israel. And unfortunately, that is the battle that is going to happen this year. And that will cause such disruption in the internet, in our way of life, and such a disruption and distraction that we will not care or even think about CERN anymore. Will that be June, July, August, September? I don't know.
I just think
it's going to happen this year.
I think you're making a good point, because we have now shifted mentally in that our representative, Barack Obama, has intentionally tried to dethrone Netanyahu and side with Iran, which puts us firmly in the bullseye of the Abrahamic covenant being fixed on us. We have crossed the line as a nation thanks to the Judas goat, Barack Obama. And when you operate at that level of power, you bring down whatever the principalities that protect nations, we are Christians, we pray for the protection of, but when your representatives violate the Bible principles on purpose, as this leadership has done, and set itself against the apple of God's eye, as he called it back then, we are in judgment, and we shall pay for our leadership, not only going against Israel, but for the widespread, I'm really livid about the widespread slaughter of the innocent, as in the blood crying out from the 70 million aborted babies that we have participated in and have not heard from our preachers who preach our best life now. And this, I believe, is the fifth seal of the martyrs under the altar saying how much longer. I think that's part of it. We have other martyrs, but of course that is part of it, the shedding of innocent blood. And I really feel that I've had an ominous feeling all week, not just from, I know that other brothers and sisters in Christ have been putting out things. I felt it before I saw their things, that I was seeing tombstones and all kinds of symbolism of death coming. And this is March. This is the God of War. We have a full eclipse. These guys worship the sun, and they worship the Roman festivals. And we've seen many that have come up that are bloody messes. And this is the time period. So, I don't know. I'm not feeling good about our position as a country, United States, as far as being life-changing dramatically in a short period of time. And I'm sorry for hogging all that period of time there, but I just felt like I needed to say that.
Yeah, we also need to keep an open mind on what the media tries to portray, you know, with, it's a stage, and, you know, whatever, if maybe they want us to believe that Obama is trying to dethrone not Netanyahu. Maybe whatever they put on the news, they want you to believe. So I try to, you know, I don't even watch it, but, you know, I hear about it, you know, I'll see videos. So I try to keep an open mind, not to play into what they want me to believe all the time. So could be true, but, you know.
Well, if we look at the stated agenda of the Illuminati, and that is to bring conflict to the world so that brother is fighting against brother and create the massive deaths that they want to achieve. And so that is what we're seeing. It doesn't matter about politics. It doesn't matter about who the leader is of any country at this point. It's the conflict that matters, and that's what they want. They want to create that conflict. Treaties, it's all smokescreen. Doesn't matter. It's all intermediate stuff. But yes, I agree with you. It's God's plan. He knows from the beginning, and he knows right now, and he knows in the end. So, you know, that's where I put my trust and my faith is in. He knows what's going on, whether we're talking about CERN or the Middle East or our present administration. Now, I want to echo, Tim, what you said about the aborted babies, because I'm adopted. I was adopted at birth. So that's a very sensitive issue for me. It's incredible that we are still here as a nation after these outright murders that have taken place of babies. And it, to me, it's nothing but demonic, that activity. Anyway, I'll get off my soapbox. Go ahead, guys.
Well, did you want to wrap up at this point in time, and we'll go enjoy the solar eclipse tomorrow and get back together, you know, Lord willing, of course.
Yeah. No, I don't want to leave it on a down note. I really want to encourage people. You know, one of the questions came up is who's controlling CERN? Who's really running this? Who's behind the scenes? We can call it Illuminati, the elite, the banksters. We can call it the corporations. We can say the United Nations is running the whole thing. Ultimately, it's Satan that's involved in all this, and we have said that repeatedly. But who on this planet is running the agenda at CERN? It's not the physicists and the engineers, obviously. They are just the worker bees who are creating this hive. In my estimation, it is the elite ruling class behind the scenes, ultimately. We talk about the hidden societies that are out there. They are the ones that are dictating why CERN exists and why every country in the world is participating in CERN. It is a tool. We've said that repeatedly. The question was posed to me by an email from one of our viewers. What about God and CERN? Will God stop CERN? And my reply was, it would only take about a 4.0 earthquake because it's a very fragile machine. And if an earthquake were to strike CERN, Switzerland, of a moderate magnitude, it would effectively knock it offline. Is that God's plan? I don't know. But it could happen. This whole thing that we're talking about could be a moot point tomorrow or September. It could never happen. And I'm completely open to that. But it's up to what God wants to do. We can divine the scriptures if we want. We can look at scriptures. We can say that maybe this is a part of the tool, a tool that is a part of scripture, opening the bottomless pit.
Yeah, I think I come to the point of just saying, do not be in love with this world. You're supposed to be in love with the Christ, the bride of Christ, waiting for the wedding feast. The things to come, what God has planned for us is much more than what we have here. Here we still have the ruler of this world, and that's the fallen cherub, you know, Satan. And so, yes, if we put our trust in God, that's where we need to be. that he is in full control of allowing, he allows free will. And so he has allowed from the cherub in the beginning his free will to rebel, to man on the earth his free will to rebel. And so this issue of rebellion is going to be dealt with one way or the other. It's who do you put your trust in? I put my trust in Jesus. You know, he is absolutely love beyond what we can comprehend. And so the other side of I've lived with, the other side I know, the other side I don't want to be around. So they lie to set, they just continue to lie and deceive you. And it's like, I know what I have with Jesus, and that he's always steered me straight when I depend on him.
Well, you know, when he was hung on the cross and the robber that believed in him said, remember me in your kingdom, and Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise.
Amen.
And he, and Jesus is God. He doesn't lie. And he's the only way that we can be alive through his spirit. And he is the gate to heaven, to God. Not any of these other things. So that's the true way to live, and that's the way to be in paradise, is to believe in him. Even the ones who hung him on the cross, they looked at him right in the face and didn't realize that he was God, that he came down here to save us from all of these things that Satan has done, all of these tricks and all these things that he has done, even to the point of this building of the CERN and everything else. It's not going to stop us from going to heaven. It's not going to stop us from living forever or from having a relationship with God, because the Bible says what we bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And I have many relationships with people in Christ that we forever will be together. And heaven's a wonderful place. It's something so wonderful to look forward to. And Jesus says to always keep our eyes, you know, keep on the watch for him, because our redemption is near and he is coming, and we are his children and we are the temple of God. We don't need a building or any type of material thing. We are the temple of God. And so, everything is going to be for his glory. Everything. Not for us and not for people to be their own God. This is for Jesus Christ, and it is for his glory.
And he brought us together. You know, he brought Anthony, Chris, and I together just for a time as this, so that we could share with everybody watching this to get ready, get oil in your lamp, as they say, and be ready, always ready, to talk of the gospel, the good news, and what Christ has done for you. And for those who aren't saved, to give you an opportunity to be saved, saved from what these people have planned for this world, who are operating behind the scenes. The spirits are operating the people behind the scenes. Like Anthony said, these scientists are compartmentalized, and they just do their projects. And it's the people behind the scenes that have a overall a spiritual-driven agenda.
Amen to that. And that's what this is all about. You and me, the three of us, and others like us, we are servants. We are servants of the Lord. Tim and I have shared privately that we've been through the stripping down, as I call it, the stripping down process in our lives. And we have come to the point where we are nothing more than humble servants. So, we're not prophets. We're here just to pass on what we believe is information that has been shared with us, and we've been enlightened to, if you will, and we hope that it helps people to come to Christ.
Right. Anyone that calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. He says so. It's his promise, and he wants everyone to repent and understand their need of a Savior. And know that he is God. So, I mean, so people can remember that, you know, that even in these end times when things get really bad, that anybody that calls on the name of Jesus will be saved.
So everybody out there, we appreciate your time being listening to us and joining in the conversation. If you have questions for Anthony, just put them in the videos. AnthonyPatch.com is where Anthony has his book, 2048 Diamonds in the Rough. Real fun read if you want to read about how the science, he has a science companion that goes with that of the things we're talking about on these hangouts. And you know, the main thing is make a spiritual decision today to follow Jesus, because we don't know if we get to do these hangouts anymore. You know, we've been lucky so far, and you know, watching the things that are going on, we know there's an Internet 2 out there, but we know they won't let us on Internet 2. None of us are getting on Internet 2.
No. Hey, let me make one quick plug, okay?
Okay, sure thing.
Now, I had a gentleman sent me a comment on one of my videos, and he said, you're just, in essence, he said, you're just doing this to sell books. Number one, I'm not. Number two, the books are terribly inexpensive as a download. They're $5. The Science Companion's $2. I'm not making any money here. That's not the point in all of this. It's just sharing the information. I've given away 90% of my books to people that, if they will email me at anthonypatchauthor.com or at gmail.com, anthonypatchauthor@gmail.com, and say, could I have your books for free? Sure, absolutely. I'll send them to you. Because I'm just a servant passing on information. I'm not here to make money off this. Now, I do want to make a plug for a gentleman who has come into my life, who has extended an incredible invitation to me to help in this information spreading. And we're doing this at cost. In fact, I'm sure we're going to lose money on the deal, but it doesn't matter. Clyde Lewis, the host of Ground Zero Radio, he broadcasts to 250 independent stations across the nation. He's right here in Portland. I'm going to give you a snapshot of the backstory on this. He didn't know me from Adam. He was doing a number of shows regarding CERN. He had his producer do a web search, found me. She calls me and says, with 4 hours lead time, can you be on the show at 8 o'clock tonight? Can you call in? I said, well, isn't your studio here in Portland? Yeah. Where are you? Well, I'm in Portland. I mean, this is just phenomenal. So anyway, I go down to the studio, meet Clyde, immediate great chemistry. The man is humble, super intelligent, outspoken, driven, believes in taking the best direction in life for everybody and sharing the message with everybody to help everybody. This man is super dedicated to helping people. So we had a great four-hour discussion on the radio. You can listen to it on my website if you like. The point is, on the 28th of this month, on March 28th, at the Hilton Hotel in Portland, Clyde has graciously created a venue for me to speak with him from 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock in the evening on Saturday the 28th at the Hilton in Portland. The tickets are $15 a head, $20 if you purchase them at the door. Again, we're not making any money off this. This is an opportunity for people to meet Clyde in person. If they want, they can meet me for whatever that's worth. But the point is, we're going to talk about a lot of the things that we've talked about in these Google Hangouts in a very encapsulated form for 3 hours. The reason we're doing this is we hope that it will be broadcast nationwide, that the mainstream media will pick this up. Not to sell the books. I'm giving the books away for free at this event. I'm not bringing books to sell, okay? This is not about me. I'm trying to get this across to people. This is about Jesus Christ and what he wants to get out to people so that they will turn to him. Not fear-mongering. This is about wake up, see the agenda, look at the nonsense that's going on, realize where the truth is, and that is with Jesus Christ. So come out 28th, if you can make it to Portland. I'll meet you. I'll greet you. Clyde will do the same. We're going to have some fun with it because God has a sense of humor.
Absolutely. So give Clyde's radio show address online so people that are listening to this, I guess we'll attach Clyde's contact information on this video in the description box.
You can Google Ground Zero Radio, Clyde Lewis. It'll pop it up to whatever affiliate you want to go to listen live. It's on his home page. You can click in on Ground Zero's webpage, and you can find his live broadcast that way as well. We hope to do a live broadcast as well of this event, but we'll see what's going to come out as far as the technical side of it.
So the day was what again?
It's the 28th, which is Saturday, 28th of March, from 6 to 9 p.m. at the Hilton Hotel in Portland, Oregon. We are
9 days. We got 9 days. Yeah, go ahead.
No, we're on the top floor. The Skyline Room looks out over the city. Absolutely incredible view of the city. This is a premier venue. We're throwing whatever it takes to put this together. Again, we won't make a dime off it. That's not the point. We're doing this to get the information out to people. Clyde and I are sincere about this. He and I have bonded like I can't believe, and I've never met the man before. So this is clearly the Lord's working.
Amen.
Clearly, he is putting this together.
So you folks listening out there, you got people in Portland that want to go see this live, get this video to them, get them the Ground Zero information, get them over there to the Hilton on the top. That's going to be fun, the Hilton top floor. Wow. Portland, Clyde Lewis, wow. Lots of fun.
It will be. Thank you.
Tell them we said hello. Wish we could be there.
Hey, you guys are going to be all over this event, okay? I'm pulling your stuff in. I'm citing you guys by name, by websites, all down the line, because it's the three of us being represented at this, along with Clyde. This is not me. This is the three of us doing the Lord's work.
And we'll try to get Chris to do a little intro thing if Clyde wants one.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That'll be a lot of fun. Okay. You want to take us out, Chris, and sign off?
Okay, sure. Thanks for watching, everybody. We'll post the next time that we'll be on. We'll have to figure out our schedule. Tim and I, we did podcasts for over a year together, 2 days a week on Freedom Talk Radio and Speaker. So those tapes are still available out there with lots of great topics and stuff. But we'll be posting. Our schedules are all different, trying to get together with Anthony, and hopefully Tim and I can get together on Tuesday, and we will let you know about Anthony when we can get back together with him. But we'll post that as soon as we know.
Yeah, leave your comments of specific questions for Anthony, and that could be a future show. Okay? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thanks for watching, everybody. Have a good day.